Welcome back from that short break. Of course, you're still watching Echoes and Tourism Radio on Urban Television. We are at the Uganda Museum and we're still getting to learn more about our history, getting into details on how these people used to go down as far as dressing is concerned.
So these are
back cloth.
I don't know if you're so familiar with the back cloth. Maybe you've used it in your life.
Yes.
Maybe
yes.
Sleeping in it, maybe wearing it. But this one is known as one of the full cultural heritage resource in Uganda and recognized by UNESCO. Yes, and it is attributed to the cultural development, especially in terms of dress, in terms of bedsheet, in terms of also decoration, by the way, but also most importantly in mummification of bodies. Because we know very well that actually history tells us that in the past people actually believed in life after death, and they believe that if you do not behave well, like treat well the deceased, he or she may come back and disturb your, you know.
Your
Do those things still exist though?
I don't know, but I've seen on news actually things happening, you know.
It could be possible. Now, Chris, if I turn right here to the clothing section, I'm looking at Salmonio dresses and Nakaima Priestess of Mubende Hill here as well. I want you to give me more details about this particular one.
Okay, this is actually known as Nakaima. It's one of the historical collection that actually made this museum people to call it the House of Fetish, Nyumba ya Mayembe.
Okay.
Because Nakaima is attributed to the Chwezi dynasty, whereby it is believed she had supernatural powers. And actually, this site is still existing and people are still using it. And it is found in Mubende, Mubende Hill. There is a tree, which is actually one of also the oldest trees, actually. It's very, very, very old. So it has different kind of caves, which are actually attributed to different houses of, you know, spirits and so on. But they're showing you how the back cloth was actually used, even in the history. It is very, very paramount. And even if you go there right now, it will be there. So it wasn't only used for, dressing as far as culture is concerned, but also it is used mainly in these kind of shrines and so on. So this place is still existing. People still go there to give in sacrifice and offerings. I've been there myself and I've stayed there for a day, and I witnessed more than 50 people actually going to that site.
Okay, interesting. What I'm seeing here that has caught my eye is the witch tree. I want you to tell me more about the witch tree. Is that the same tree that you're talking about that is in Bende, or this is another one?
Yeah, that is the witch tree actually attributed to Nakaima spirits. It even has caretakers today, and it is regarded as like a faith best kind of site.
Do we have people who go there for worshipping purposes?
Many of them, and even giving in sacrifices and so on. Right. Recently I met two women. One actually told me that she was sleeping and she had a baby. The baby had never walked and so on. And she was telling me that the spirits told her to go there and, you know, the baby would be treated. And when I saw the baby, the guy was, you know, running and so on. And she said the guy was not walking. So these things.
So the spirits made the baby walk.
Possibly, if you believe. No.
So in case you have any problems, you could be able to visit Mubende.
It is still active, actually. People still use it.
So it's a famous place. The moment you get there and ask for the witch tree, they'll definitely show it.
It's known.
Okay.
Yeah, it's known. Yeah, this is a demonstration of how the Kalamoja mother is actually behaving with the skin, because the Kalamajongs, just like the Ankole people, are known in cattle keeping. But it wasn't only used for meat or of blood or milk, but also the hide. So these are dresses, actually. You can see how the mother is carrying the baby, still using the skin. And also they're showing us the skirt made from the skin. So this one actually takes us back to fashion and design. I think fashion and design has been existing even in the less technologized kind of societies, if you can.
In the 50s,
yes, people have been doing it. So you can see, and even today, contemporarily, you can see different kind of, you know, dresses designed in this different.
I mean, this has some design in it. Not anyone can come up with this.
Yeah, I mean, then these are different kind of, jewelry. Yeah, and then this is still the dressing. This is a busuti, which is also known as gomas. And then this is the kanzu or the tunic. And you know, that is known.
I like the sandals, though.
The sandals.
They used to be wooden, right?
Yeah, of course. People had these, actually. You may ask how people used them, but that was really very, very, very instrumental in the society. People were using them as shoes. But today, because of the technological advancement, you can see the different shoes we are using. But back here, this busuti you're seeing, it has a history in the making, how it became to be used as a gomesi or busuti or kade.
Okay.
And it is known to be used by the Gayaza High School, actually, as their uniform, boarding uniform. That is how it is now coming in to be called boarding. Gayaza High School girls were actually in boarding. It's a boarding school.
It's a boarding school, yes.
So they used to have it, you know,
so
after
school. Yeah. Body.
Yeah, and kade, if you hear people, someone say kade, that is the one they use, like, you know, for daily kind of, you know.
I didn't know that is where the name boarding came from. Thank you very much to the Gayaza people for initiating that one.
Introduced by a person called Gomez. That's why also it's called Gomez.
Yeah. Gomez. Yeah. Gomez was a Muganda?
No, he was an Asian kind of fashion designer. So he was asked to design a dress for the queen of that time when they were planning for their wedding.
Okay.
Then later on it was adopted by girls' school girls. But it has different kind of stories on how it developed. And so it's upon me and you to do more research about it.
That's true.
Yeah. And so this is the traditional architecture that shows us how people used to construct houses. But these ones, they are the mimic of, you know, the high supreme kind of house for the kings. This is Bunyoro, that is Ankore, and the other one is Buganda Kingdom. So that is the mimic of Kasubi tombs, which was actually burnt in 2010. And so they just put it there to show us the mimic on how people used to construct. And when we were entering this section, ethnographic section, we saw at the entrance, actually, that is the same kind of, you know, setting which is there. And what I want you to know is that these guys, the subjects of these kings, always got an idea of construction or making anything, like getting a riff from you know, their superiors. Just like the way if you have a kid, like maybe a boy, sometimes he's like, I want to dress up like my dad, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I want to be like my dad.
Yes.
I want to be like so and so. That's because that's where they get the inspiration. But also, the king, like for example in Buganda, was also taken to be somebody of religious inspiration, but also leadership inspiration. So many people would go and, you know, ask for blessings and so on. Even today, people still go at Kasubi tombs. So you can bear me witness, if you go there today, you would see people actually.
I have been there once, actually.
You've been there?
Yeah, yeah.
Ah, okay. This is about discovery of crimes. Today we have modern courts, you know, and justice, politically actually brought in, you know, in the process.
Yes.
But these guys actually, even today, they have, or they used to have, different kind of ways on how to solve disputes in the families, in the villages, and so on. So, an example, these are some of the divination, you know, pots which were used by the Rukbara, we have the speaking horn. It is believed that the horn would speak out who committed, especially after performing rituals and so on.
Oh, the horn would speak and say that Chris is the one who did this.
Yeah, that is according to the oral history we have, we get, and also different kind of papers we read. People of then used to do that kind of form. But also we have different other kind of objects which are used in the process of discovering the crimes, and it depended on which kind of crime you committed. Even today, we have guys who have been, you know, sentenced to death, depending on the crime. So,
was sentencing someone to death one of the punishments back then, like hanging them or something?
Yes, yes. For example, if you look at that, like for example, the Arul knife, we have the, the rope from the gun and so on. Those were the punishment kind of tools which were used if you were going to be beheaded,
okay,
or if you're going to be, you know. And then the fetish, you're seeing the necklace you're seeing there, it is believed it was used as a way of actually corrupting the prisoners not to escape.
Was this our arsenal?
Probably I can say but I normally call them AK-47s of then.
Okay.
We talked about and smelting, and these are some of the products you're seeing, the spears and so on. And if you look closely, actually you see the differences in size and shape. And also they have different kind of names attributed to them, like Hima Teso. That means that this is something to do with the Hima people, the Teso people. That is the kind of spear they normally use. This one doesn't necessarily mean that these guys made them. As I told you before, these things were acquired from the producers. Just like the way today you'd want to put on a nice shoe and you go to the shop. But the shops do not make these shoes.
They import them or bring them from somewhere.
Yes.
Well, quite interesting. It seems like recreation did not only just happen now, but even way back. I mean, to the fact that we still have a Chugwe Chiganda that was, you know, an activity that was carried out back in the day. It is an interesting one. We have seen the sliding, which we have been victims. Yes, you know what I'm talking about. Just sliding and, you know, the next thing you know is just chiboko on your bums because you have been doing something that your parents did not want to do. We're trying to find out more about how these people live their lives here at the Uganda Museum. But unfortunately, our third episode has come to an end, but we still have more episodes lined up for you. All you need to do is make sure you keep tabs on this particular one every Sunday at 8 p.m. right here on Urban Television. Until next time, my name is Derek Ainedasha. I'll see you on the fourth episode, and this time round, we could be talking about Idi Amin. Yeah, you remember Idi Amin. This guy had, I don't know how many, what are they called? You know, are they called dadas as well? I don't know what they are called, but general, brigadier, whatever those things are. We'll be finding out more about him next week on the show. Keep it live with us on Urban Television. I'm out. Peace.